Denver 8 TV, your city, your source.
What started several years ago as a reporting project that led to the long journey home has continued to grow. I'm Tamara Banks, and I've recently returned from South Sudan again. On this edition of Dialogue Denver DA, Mitch Morrissey says he is going to interview me about the humanitarian project that I've been working on for years. Hello, everyone. Welcome to Dialogue Denver DA. Mitch, so great to be with you again, but I have to tell you, it's a little awkward, and I'm humbled and honored that you were interested in hearing about my projects in Sudan and South Sudan.
Well, you know, Tamara, I think that the work that you're doing is so important that we really do need to get the message out, and if there's anybody that can help you, obviously, that's a big part of the work that you're doing. So, actually, as a trial lawyer, before I became the DA, I was in the position where I used to ask a lot of questions. So hopefully I'll be able to pull this off. The other thing is that you've been doing our show now for about 2 years, and I want to thank you for that. When Harry died, and many people probably remember Harry, we were looking for someone, and you were willing to do that. And I know you have an incredibly busy schedule, oftentimes out of the country. So we're just happy that you've been able to do that. But I wanted to just kind of take a page out of your book and ask you, first of all, could you give us just a short bio about you and where you started and why you do what you do?
Well, sure. I've been in TV news, primarily TV news, for 20-something years now, and a long stretch here in Denver at WB2 News, and then more recently at Fox 31. And in about 2006 or so, I decided I wanted to do something a little bit different, and I actually worked for then-Mayor Hickenlooper as one of his advisors in neighborhoods and community, which was really fun. But I still had this news bug in me, so I stepped out on my own and started to do freelancing, which is a great position when the phone is ringing, and it's not a real great job if the phone isn't ringing. But fortunately, I've been able to get sort of a good resume underneath me, and I'm working now for not just you guys, but Al Jazeera America. I've done work for World Report, which was on the HDNet network where Dan Rather works, and a number of other stations, BBC and PBS.
And what kind of background? Education-wise, did you grow up in Denver? What kind of background do you have to get into what you've done?
My family is, a lot of my family is from actually Louisiana and also from Iowa, so very non-Denver folks, but my parents moved here in the mid-60s and decided this was a great place to live, and I'm glad that they moved us here out of the South in particular, because it was a really tough time to live in rural Louisiana. But I went to UNC, and I also have worked around the country and local affiliates, and I'm a Bear down to the bone. Go Bears.
And so you've been in primarily in Denver once you got back here and started working for the different news agencies.
Well, I've worked in Albuquerque, I've worked in Dallas and Colorado Springs, and then Denver. And then since I've been in Denver, when I got the job at WB2 News in Denver in the 1993, I've primarily been stationed and based here in Denver, right?
And you won some awards. You have some Emmys under your belt. Can you tell us about that?
I have a couple. It's really difficult to be the one in this seat answering the questions, I have to admit. But I am proud to say that I've worked with a great team of photographers and producers that have helped us win Emmys for the Sudan pieces and Colorado Broadcasters Association awards, awards with the National Association of Black Journalists, Associated Press, a couple others. I don't really, you know, keep them a list on me. But I think what it takes to win those kinds of that level of both local and national recognition is a really good team, people that you can trust, and those who trust you. When I go to South Sudan, every time I've gone, I just came back from my seventh trip. I've shot the video myself, and I'm here to say I'm not a photographer, but in the situations that I'm in, I kind of try to go in under the radar. So my producers and photographers are really the ones that get the credit for all those, you know, statues at home in my living room. It really takes a team.
And really, what was it about Africa that drew your attention and got you going towards this project and the work that you're doing?
I've always been drawn to Africa, even before I went as a little girl, and the Middle East. I think it's just a fascinating place. So two things. One, my first trip to Africa was in the late 1999, and the first country I went to on the continent was Kenya, and I felt like I'd actually come home. It's an amazing, beautiful place, and the people are wonderful. The countryside, the Maasai warriors, the animals, the giraffes and zebra run wild here like our deer do here. So it was just a great pull. And then, of course, visiting Haiti, doing stories in Haiti, that's not Africa, of course, but it's a black nation, if you will, because of the slaves that ended up there, or former slaves. And then in 2000, or right after 9/11, understandably, everybody had this fear of anyone who was darker complected, especially if you were Muslim or of Arab descent. And I thought, there's more to the Middle East than, you know, what happened during 9/11. So at the time, I wasn't able to get into Iraq, and we hadn't invaded Iraq yet, but I was able to get into Jordan. And I've covered stories and written stories in about Jordan and the amazing place that it is, as well as in Kuwait. And when you think of where humanity sort of started, that's sort of the cradle of humanity,
sure,
right? There were
sure,
some of the
absolutely.
Greatest, you know, biggest religions started. And so I think we should be engaged in having conversations and understanding folks from the other parts of the world, particularly the Middle East and Africa.
So when you started on the Sudan issue, and it sounds to me like there's a common theme here. You're looking at places where there's strife, potential war, poverty, maybe famine, that type of situation. Is that what draws you to these countries, or what is the story there?
Part of it is, I mean, I'm not completely altruistic. It's the competition of finding a story that no one else is reporting on. And then having a love for the people who somehow are resilient regardless of what's happening to them. Right around 2007 or 8 or so, I really started doing more research on genocide because it's always fascinated me. Why after all this time, 21st century, we're still talking about genocide? After the Holocaust, we said never again. After Rwanda, we said never again. And here we're talking about slavery and genocide. So I got involved and became a board member for the Colorado Coalition for Genocide Awareness and Action, which Roz Duman, who used to work for Mayor Wellington Webb years ago, she founded that. And it's a group of people who are interested in raising the awareness about genocide around the world. And so then I met a number of the board members, one of them, Pastor Heidi McGinnis, who's an abolitionist. She lives here in Denver. Her organization that she works for, Christian Solidarity International, is doing slave liberation every month. So what that means is that their office, based in Zurich, with about 4, 5, or 6 people, very small nonprofit, goes to places, particularly this South Sudan and Sudan, where Christians are being persecuted. In this particular case, it was black indigenous people who were being, during the civil war between 1985 and 2005, the militia, Janjaweed, were sent down from the north, from Khartoum, into the south and raided villages. And whoever they didn't kill, they took back up to the north as slaves. So today, sanctioned slavery continues to go on. And so there's this underground sort of Harriet Tubman slave liberation process that goes on, along with not just the people based in Zurich and Pastor Heidi here in Denver, but really the grassroots group that's in South Sudan, the Dinka and the other tribes that are there.
Well, you used a term that I wanted to ask you about, because you said you were able to get in. Mm-hmm. And when you were talking about Jordan and the Middle East, and it sounds like you have that same kind of challenge when it comes to Sudan, South Sudan. What do you mean? What would the someone watching the show that had that question, what does that entail?
So For example, this last time, this last trip that I took in May and April, I was scheduled to go in December because I wanted to go to an area called the Nuba Mountains, which since 2011, the president of the north part of Sudan has been bombing these folks because that area is rich with minerals and oils, and the folks want to stay and live there and become autonomous. But the president saying, no, you will either succumb to us and be, you know, part of Sudan, or we'll bomb the hell out of you. And so that's what they've been doing. But while that is going on, in December, there was inner conflict between the leadership of the vice president, the former vice president, and the president of South Sudan, which just became a brand new country in 2011. So while there's this world attention with, about what's happening in South Sudan, the people in the Nuba Mountains, their fate is being eclipsed by this bigger picture down south. So what that means is I have to get travel permits from various grassroots groups and the military, the SPLA, the Sudan People's Liberation Army, to be able to travel in these conflict zones, because it's really dangerous to go, and you want to make sure you're trying to go with somebody, and at the very least have some sort of piece of paper that says you're allowed to travel in this area. And the sophistication of those groups isn't always the same bar that we have here in the States. When I was embedded with the U.S. Army in Iraq, while we were in the middle of the war in 2009, I understood that my safety was in jeopardy, but it was a little bit different than being in South Sudan.
Tell me about that safety issue. Obviously, it sounds, if you're your own camera person and you're doing 99 or 100% of the work on these stories, how is safety a factor? How do you deal with that?
So a lot of people ask me, including my family, they say, do you have armed, you know, gunmen with you? Are you wearing a bulletproof vest? And yes and no, not wearing Kevlar like I did in Iraq. But there are people on the ground who know where to go, they know the language, they know what places to go to, what places not to go to. They're familiar with the situation currently happening. And while some of them sometimes are armed, the SPLA, this last trip, they were armed, young soldiers with me. The best defense is knowing your situation and knowing where you are. And the danger is, too, being a woman, I don't want to put myself in jeopardy, which is a different situation scenario than a man. I don't want to put the team in jeopardy, too.
So you don't travel with the team, though. It sounds to me like the team is there. You get together with them and you go to the area that you have the permits to go to.
I'll meet them there. I'll get embedded with various groups. For example, with the abolitionists, CSI, just two or three people, and I might meet them there, or I might go with one person, Pastor Heidi here, and we'll go in, but it's a very small group, and then we'll meet the indigenous people there to help us get around. This last trip, I went with a gentleman who's became a naturalized American citizen, but he's from the Nuba Mountains, and he's been going back, especially since 2011, since the area has been being bombed, to try to take food and medicines in. So George Tuto and I left. We went together and met a team out in the middle of nowhere. And but in terms of the shooting, the producing, shooting, and editing and writing, it is me.
Well, I think that, and this is really interesting, I'm finding it fascinating, but I think it's time that we need to take a break, and then we'll come back and continue the conversation. Thank you.
Moment.
I'll never forget that moment.
That changed my life.
At that moment, it hit me. This is why I joined the Guard. We're soldiers, always ready to protect our country. But we've also got communities. Family, friends, neighbors who count on us. I couldn't believe it. I just saved a life. Somebody from my hometown.
See what it means to be a citizen soldier at NationalGuard.com.
The Mental Health Center of Denver helps children and families by focusing on prevention, early intervention, and treatment. Because healthy families grow from a foundation of mental wellness. Learn more at mhcd.org.
Ah!
Welcome back. We're talking to Tamara Banks. Tamara, I want to thank you for allowing me to interview you. I know that that's a big change. I wanted to know, with the things that you tape, the stories that you do, are you doing the work for the different organizations that are trying to stop the slavery, that type of thing? Are they using your material, or how does that work?
That's a really good question, and no, they're not. And this is that fine line between, am I, you know, doing a piece on the people, on that organization, which sometimes I'm doing it on them, but not for them. And, you know, we have interesting conversations about how much they can tell me. And then there's a lot of information that's off the record because we're living in tents, and there's conversations that, you know, I can't exactly go to a different part, you know, of the tent to have these conversations. It's not for them. And we trust each other, the various organizations, because they'll take some pictures of me. I'll need still photos of me actually shooting. And that's real helpful sometimes, so that I can post that on my website and things like that. And I'll help them with their camera gear if they actually do have camera gear. And you know, you do have this close relationship, but I'm not doing the work for them. So sometimes I think that would be nice, because then they could pay me to do the work. But it doesn't. I don't want it to be that way, because I'm trying to walk that journalistic line and be, you know, close to them, but as autonomous as possible, to really keep this in the vein of journalism versus PR.
You mentioned a website. Can you give us that website?
Absolutely. It's SudanUntoldStories.com. And on there you can find out more about what I'm doing. I promise myself every week I'm going to get, you know, more engaged in that website. I'm just so busy. But you can find out about, you know, see some of the pictures and stories I've done and some of the events when we have screenings and that sort of thing. So SudanUntoldStories.com is a place to go.
And Tamara, how do you support this important work? It sounds to me, that's why I asked the question, if they are actually paying you to make a story about them, that type of thing. How do you fund these trips?
It's pretty much self-funded. I have fundraisers, once in a while, but that in and of itself just takes so much time, and so I don't do those that often. But when I do, I try to post those and let people know that I have fundraisers. People can go to the website again and find out how they can donate if they just watch this and they want to get engaged. I'm not a 501c3. I don't have the time or energy or desire to do that, but one of the PBS stations here in Denver, Colorado Public Television, is my fiscal agent. They're a 501c3, so it helps with the tax issues if people want to donate, so that's really helpful.
So you can get donations, mm-hmm. and then they can get a write-off, mm-hmm. and they can help you continue to tell these compelling stories.
Exactly, yeah. Every once in a while I get lucky. I call it, and BBC wants to pick up a story, I'll approach them, and it's written differently for, you know, say BBC World Radio than it would be for a TV or movie documentary. So I do work for them, and they'll pay me for that slice of work. Al Jazeera America in end of December, January, when I couldn't get in because the country just shut down because of an alleged coup at the time, I was able to work with Al Jazeera English and work with the crew in Nairobi to meet with some people, and we sort of figured out a way to tell the story without my actually being able to go in. But by and large, it's 99.9% donations and my piggy bank.
So if I tell people, go on the line, help Tamara tell these stories, I really want you to think about what, I know you must have many, many compelling stories, but is there one or two you can share with us in the time that we have left?
Yeah, I mean, there's so many. I mean, the country on so many levels is beautiful. South Sudan, it's the world's newest country. But the United Nations just recently announced that they are at the brink of a famine because of the conflict. And I was able to get some video of some of the people that were living in these thatched areas that were refugees. They were just had to run literally on their feet from, in this case, the Nuba Mountains, about 50 miles away, and try to find a place where they could just stabilize. And NGOs can't get into most of these places. I was able to fly in with an NGO that swore me to secrecy because they're not even supposed to be going in.
NGO stands for?
Non-governmental organization. It's basically a nonprofit that works on an international level. And they flew us in, me and George and my bodyguard, and they dropped us off. We were in a caravan, one of those little planes, dropped us off. I felt like I was on the edge of the earth. Like if I'd taken maybe 20 steps a little bit more this way, I'd just like drop off the edge of the earth because there was nothing around. It took 2.5 hours to that flight to get from Juba, the capital of South Sudan, to this area called Kodok. And they said, okay, well, we'll pick you up in a week unless one of two things occur. Number one, the rainy season starts early and this dirt strip that we landed on is too muddy to land and take off from, or number two, insecurity. If the rebels from, well, not really the rebels, but the government in the north encroaches upon this area, we can't come in if security is unstable. So the first sign of rain that week, I was just like, okay, I need to get out of here because they weren't coming back for another 2 months if they weren't able to get in at that particular time.
Now, when you say the north, is it that you go into the south and go into the north, or are you allowed in the north? You're telling stories that I would think the north would not be too proud of.
Yeah.
That they don't want the world to know.
That's right.
So how does that work?
I don't fly in through Khartoum, through Sudan, through the north. I go in through Juba, South Sudan, because of the stories I've done about the government of Sudan. The president there, Omar Bashir, has been indicted by the ICC, the International Criminal Court, as for crimes against humanity and genocide. Quite frankly, he's a terrorist thug and continues to be able to torture the people in his own region. So typically, I go in through the south, and then if I'm doing stories just over the side on the other side of the border, I am in fact, you know, breaking the law because I don't have a passport and travel privileges to go into that north part. But that's why people don't see these stories that often. Eric Reeves has written stories. Nicholas Kristof from the New York Times has written some stories. There's a few organizations out there, but it's just so difficult to get to that it's hard to commit a crew to get up in that area and talk about the plight of these people.
And when you tell a story, how do you select what you're going to do? Is it going to be an individual? Is it going to be a group? The Nubia people, I think they're called. Is it you're telling their story? Are you going to select a woman and tell the kind of things that she's confronted there? How do you go about telling your different stories?
Well, it's a good question because it's such a big bite to bite off. And what I try to do is figure out the focus. Is it the story about the abolitionists and the slaves that are being freed? So that's one story. They're a character. Is the character a former lost boy of Sudan, Daniel Majok Guy, who ended up in Denver as a lost boy and went back several years later to South Sudan right after it became a brand new country to help the organization based here in Denver, Project Education South Sudan, build schools and get that educational infrastructure. So he was my character. In this particular case, the last couple years I've been going, the character is the Nuba Mountains broadly, and specifically the culture that is, you know, not too far from becoming extinct, because what's happening everywhere else in the world, also in South Sudan, is being eclipsed by what's happening to these folks. So my goal this last trip was to talk to the people about their culture. What does their dance look like? Does their music look like? What are their favorite sports? Wrestling is huge with the Nuba people. And so they were able to recreate a couple of wrestling matches for me. And I had the opportunity to meet with 5 or 6 different groups and tribes of people. And every single group wanted to share their dance and their song. And I was able to capture all of that on tape. So it's not just showing people starving and drinking mud water and dying on the side of the road trying to get to safety to refugee camp. It's also about showing that this is a culture. These are people. I mean, imagine if the Denver Art Museum was wiped out and everything that spoke about Denver was killed off, or, you know, the Louvre in Paris. We wouldn't know. What if Hitler had been successful in abolishing and getting rid of, destroying all that beautiful art in Germany. So many things we wouldn't know about, not just the Jewish community, but other peoples as well. So that's sort of the character now.
So you're documenting something that may very well end up ending at some point.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, when I was just there, there were 3,175 refugees who had come from the Nuba Mountains to just on the other side of the border in South Sudan to safety. And they kind of created their own refugee camp because no one was able to get to them. And they're a handful of people, and they're about to become extinct. And this isn't my term. These are terms from scholars, from people who actually know what they're talking about. And it was beautiful to have them be able to sing and dance for a change. And it's sort of, you could just see their spirit elevated, and they needed to know that they are somebody, if you will, that they really matter in the world, and that they have a culture and a history. So I'm really hoping that, you know, I can get that word out. If George Clooney would just work with me on these projects, because he has a heart for South Sudan.
And I imagine he could write a pretty good size
check. I think he could write a
check.
You
know, Tamara, we're about out of time, and I just want to thank you so much for telling this story and letting us know. But the other thing is, where can we go and see these stories, to see the work that you're doing other than your website?
There's a lot of work, a lot of my work on YouTube. And if you just go to YouTube and type in Tamara Banks, South Sudan, you'll see a lot of work there. So that's I'm really grateful for YouTube.
Tamara, it's just an honor that I got to ask you these questions. I think that Denver needs to know what you're doing. Thank you for what you're doing. And I hope that they're successful over there in ending slavery and ending those crimes that you've seen and documented. But thank you so much for being our guest on Dialogue Denver DA.
Denver 8 TV, your city, your source.